Now today we will take a chapter which is in the subject of physics class 11th, chapter number 9, and the name of the chapter is Mechanical Properties of Solids. In that chapter we will take a topic, and that topic is Elastic Behavior of Solids. We will discuss it. Later on we will discuss stress and strain. That is, today we will go, first of all we will study what is elastic behavior of solids, and then elastic behavior of solids. Elastic behavior of solids, you know, solids are composed of atoms and molecules. Solids are those substances which have definite shape and definite size. And these solids are made of atoms and molecules. In order to understand the elastic behavior of solids, we will take microscopic view into consideration. What the microscopic view is, that each solid is composed of atoms and molecules. That means solids are composed of atoms or molecules. These atoms and molecules are bound together by a force, and that force is called intermolecular force. Solids molecules are atoms in a solid are bound together by a force and by a force called intermolecular force or interatomic force. So let us take, if we have a solid and we take a cube of the solid, for example, let us take a solid in a cubical form. And we see the atoms are arranged in this cube, by a manner such that each atom is held together by a force. That force is called interatomic force. So interatomic force is the force which is responsible to hold the atoms of a solid together. When this solid is free, that means we don't have applied any force to the solid, these atoms are at their equilibrium positions. That means they have the minimum energy at that position. Now if we apply external force, the atoms may displace from their positions, and the shape of this solid may change. When we subject it to external force. In order to study the elastic behavior of solids, in order to visualize the elastic behavior of solids, let us consider a spring ball model. Let us consider a spring ball model. Say, for example, we have a spring and we have atoms. This ball, this ball represent atoms in the solid. While as the spring, it represents inter-atomic or intermolecular force. So, in order to visualize this, the atomic behavior of solids, we have considered two atoms, and these two atoms are held together by means of a spring. So, let us we will see the spring ball model like this. You look, students, like at this spring, and we have this two balls. So this spring, it represents the intermolecular force with which the atoms are bind together, and this spring and this the balls, they represent the atoms in a solid. For simplicity, we have taken only two solids held, two molecules held by means of a spring. So you know, when we expand this spring, when we stretch this spring, so restoring force will develop in it. That means when we stretch this spring, its shape is deformed, the location of the atoms is displaced, and the spring will come in a stress. And when we leave these, when we remove the external force, when we remove the deforming force, the spring will come to their equilibrium position. So it is restoring force which is responsible to bring the atoms to their their original positions, to their equilibrium positions. So it is this is happening in the solid. When external force is applied to the solid, its atoms gets displaced, and due to interatomic or intermolecular forces, when we remove the external force, when we remove the deforming force, these atoms will come to their equilibrium position. So this shows the elastic behavior of the solid. So elastic behavior of the solid is because of the interatomic or intermolecular force. Let the original distance between the two atoms is R1. When we stretch the spring, restoring force develops in it. The direction of restoring force is inwards. The restoring force develops in it. That restoring force will bring these two atoms to their equilibrium positions. Similarly, we can compress the spring. The spring can be compressed like this. Due to this external force, FEX or FT, deforming force. FD is deforming force. Due to this, we have applied deforming force to the spring. The spring is compressed. And restoring force develops in the spring. Its direction in up is in outward direction. That means opposite direction to the deforming force. So when here also when we release like this, if we compress the spring, restoring force develops in it, and that restoring force brings the spring to their equilibrium positions. So it is the restoring force which is developed in the solids. That restoring force gives them the elastic behavior of solids. So elastic behavior of solid is simply the force which is developed. That means, or you can say, it is simply the displacement of atoms from their equilibrium positions due to external force. And when we have removed the external force, that these atoms will come to their equilibrium positions again, and it gives the elastic behavior of the solid. Now we have some terms are related to elasticity. Terms related to elasticity. One term is deforming force. First term we have deforming force. Deforming force is simply when we have, it is the external force given to a solid and by which the atoms in or molecules in the solid may displace. We have applied the force, and this force has changed the shape, it has deformed the shape of this spring, and the force which we have applied to this spring is called deforming force. That means deforming force has changed the shape of the solid. Deforming force. The external force are responsible to deform the shape of a solid is called deforming force. Deforming force. Second, we have restoring force. Restoring force is the force which is responsible to restore the shape of the solid, or which is responsible to bring the atoms or molecules in a solid to their original positions. That means if we have this spring, we have deformed its shape, and in that spring, what is developed? Restoring force is developed. That restoring force will bring this spring to their equilibrium position or to their original position. So the force responsible to bring the spring to their original position is called restoring force. The force responsible to bring the solids, that is atoms or molecules, to their original positions. Positions is called restoring force. Is called a restoring force. Are the force responsible to regain the shape of a body is called a restoring force. Now third term we have elasticity. Third is elasticity. Elasticity, it is the property in the solid by virtue of which the solid regain its original position or original configuration. So that means the property by which the solid regain its original configuration is called elasticity. So we can simply write property by virtue of which the solid regains its original configuration. What the configuration mean? Configuration means its shape, size, volume. Property by virtue of which the solid regains its original configuration is called elasticity. Elasticity of the solid. Elasticity of the solid is also developed by the restoring force. Now we have another term that is called perfectly elastic body. Perfectly elastic body. Perfectly elastic body is that body which regains its original configuration immediately and completely after removing the deforming force. That means if this spring is perfectly elastic body, look at the spring. If this spring, we call this, it is perfectly elastic body. If we deform the spring and after removing the deforming force, if it regains its original configuration completely and immediately after removing the deforming force, this body is said to be perfectly elastic body. Like this, if we release the external force, it will regain its original configuration completely and immediately. So this body is, we call this body perfectly elastic body. So we can write perfectly elastic body, we can write it is that type of elastic body which regains its original. It is original configuration its original configuration completely. And immediately. And immediately after removing deforming force. So when we have removed the deforming force and the body has regained completely and immediately original configuration, we call such a body as perfectly elastic body. But in real life, there is no perfectly elastic body. We don't have perfectly elastic body. Nearly elastic bodies, we have nearly perfectly elastic body. We have examples like phosphor brooms. Phosphor brooms. Phosphor brooms is the example of nearly perfectly elastic body. Phosphor brooms are cots. Cots fiber. Can I write another example? Is Cots fiber. These are the examples of nearly perfectly elastic bodies. But we don't have perfectly, or we don't have ideal elastic body. Its degree varies from material to material. Similarly, we have another, that is term fifth, another term that is perfectly plastic bodies. Perfectly plastic body. Perfectly plastic body is that body which does not regain its shape, which does not regain its original configuration, or it does not regain its shape at all after removing the deforming force. Whatsoever the force, what small the force may be applied, and the body does not regain its original, the perfectly plastic body is how much the force we will apply to a body, and if it does not change its shape, then we call such a body as perfectly plastic bodies. That means howsoever we apply force to a body, and there will be no displacement or in the atoms or molecules, and the body will be in a fixed position, and there will be no deformation in the body, such a body is called perfectly plastic body. That means the body which does not change its shape, its configuration rather. It is configuration. Howsoever the deforming force is applied. Applied on it. That means whatsoever we apply the force on a body, and the body does not change its configuration, does not deform its shape, we call such a body as perfectly plastic body. And we don't have, similarly, in case of elastic bodies, we don't have completely elastic body. Similarly, we in this plastic bodies, perfectly plastic, we don't have perfectly or ideal plastic body. The plasticity of the body, varies from material to material. Now, nearly examples of nearly plastic, perfectly plastic bodies. Perfectly plastic bodies. We have mud, putty, paraffin wax, are the nearly perfectly plastic bodies. That means if there is a small displacement, the body will not regain its shape whatsoever. If there is a small displacement in the atoms, if there is small deformation in the body produced due to force, and the body is not able to regain its shape, regain its configuration, such a body is called a perfectly plastic body. Stress and strain. Now we have gone through the elasticity of the bodies, or we have gone through the elastic behavior of the bodies. We have studied it. Now we will discuss what is stress and what is strain. First, we will talk of stress. Stress is the restoring force developed per unit area in the body. That means when we have changed the shape of the body, and when we have applied external force to the body, like you look at this spring, when we have applied the force to this body, its shape is deformed, its shape is changed. At the same time, there will be a restoring force developed in the body that is responsible to bring the body to their original position. The restoring force developed in the body per unit area is called stress. That means stress is the restoring force developed per unit area when the body is under the application of external force. So we can say it is the restoring force per unit area developed in the deformed body. Simply we can write stress is equal restoring force divided by area of the body, per unit area of the body. Sometimes this restoring force is equal and opposite to the deforming force. So in some bodies, this restoring force is equal and opposite to the deforming force. Then at that time, we can write stress is equal to deforming force per unit area. It is only when restoring force is equal to the
deforming force.
Deforming force. Then we can write stress is equal to deforming force per unit area. Now this is stress. That means stress is simply the restoring force or deforming force. Sometimes when restoring force is equal to deforming force, restoring force divided by per unit area or deforming force developed per unit area is called stress. Now units of stress. Units of stress. Since we know stress is equal to force, restoring force divided by area. So we'll talk first SI unit. SI unit, that is standard international unit system. We know the SI unit of force is Newton. And the SI unit of area is meter square. So we can say SI unit of stress is Newton per meter square, or we can write it is equal to Pascal. Pascal. It is the SI unit of stress. Similarly, we have CGS unit. CGS unit. CGS unit is CGS unit of force is dyne, and the CGS unit of area is centimeter. Centimeter square. So we can have dyne per centimeter square is the CGS unit of stress. Now we have types, dimensions of stress. Dimensions we can write dimensional formula. Dimensional formula is force. We know force is equal to mass into acceleration. So mass, dimension of mass is m, and the dimension of acceleration l t minus 2 divided by length. Dimension of length is l square. So we can have dimensions of this stress, dimensions of stress, then dimensional formula of stress will be m1 l minus 1 t minus 2. It is the dimensional formula of stress. Now we have types of stress. What will be the type of the stress? How many types stress will produce in a body? So we'll study this. Types of stress. So this you know, we can change the configuration of a body by means of three ways. Either we change its length, or we change its volume, we change its shape. Volume can be changed, length can be changed, that means increased or decreased, or shape can be changed. Shape of the body can change. So by changing the length, by changing the volume, by changing the shape, we have three types of stress. One type is, we call this stress, that is called normal stress. Normal stress. Second is volume stress. Volume stress, or another name of this is bulk stress. bulk citrus. Third, we have shear citrus. Shear citrus. So normal citrus is by changing the length of the body. This is by changing the volume of the body. This is by changing the shape of the body. So we have these three types of citrus. We will go one by one to discuss these types of citrus. First, we have normal citrus. Normal citrus we mean when we deform a body and it develops restoring force, and that restoring force is directed perpendicular to the body, to the area of the body. That means the force, the restoring force which is developed in the body, and its direction is perpendicular to the area of the body. To the area, the restoring force developed perpendicularly to the area of the body is called normal stress. That means when restoring force is perpendicular to the area of the body, then that type of stress is called normal stress. So we can write this stress: restoring force per unit area. Restoring force developed per unit area to a body perpendicular to the area. The area is called normal stress. Is called normal stress. That means when restoring force is developed in the body normally to its surface, that type of stress is called normal stress. Now this normal stress has also two types. This normal stress has also two types. It has two types. One type we have longitudinal longitudinal or compressional stress, or in short we can write it is also called tensile stress is the change in the length of a body. That means we can increase the length or we can decrease the length. And that type of stress, the stress developed then a body, is called longitudinal stress or tensile stress. Now we have another, is tensile stress, or second is compressional stress. One type we have tensile stress, or that is called tensile stress, means by increasing the length of the body. Second is compressional stress. It means when we decrease the length of a body and stress developed perpendicular to the area of the cross section of the body is called compressional system. We can show it by means of this spring. When we have stretched this spring, then longitudinal stress is developed in it. Longitudinal stress, that means the restoring force developed perpendicular to the area of this cross section, area of the cross section of this length, is called tensile stress or longitudinal stress. Compressional stress means when we decrease the length of an object and the restoring force developed per unit area, and that is direction of the restoring forces outwards, is called, then that is called compressional stress. Compressional stress. So that means when we have tensile stress means change in length of the body. If this is the original length of the body, let its length is L originally. But when I have applied force to this body, its length is increased. Due to this force, external force, its length is increased. Let its length is increased by L plus delta L. Delta L is the increase in length. So then the stress which is developed in this body, and that stress is perpendicular to the area of cross section of the body, and that is called tensile stress. Second is compressional stress. Compressional stress means when we decrease the length of a body, the length of a rod and or length of a spring by compressing it, and the restoring force developed in it and whose direction is perpendicular to the area of the cross section of the rod, and that area of cross section of rod, that means the restoring force developed in the body perpendicular to the area of the cross section of the body is called compressional stress. That means here, by the compressional stress, the length of the body is decreased. That means if its length is L without applying force, when we compress the body, its length by applying external force, its length decreases. That means it's L minus delta L. So at that time, the length of the body is decreased, and that body is under compressional stress. That means the force, the restoring force is developed, which is perpendicular to the area of the cross-section of the body. Area of the cross-section of the body, that is called restoring stress. Now we have another concept that we call as tangential stress. I already told you the stress can be produced by three ways. By changing the length, you have seen these types of stress, compressional stress or tensile stress. And both of the stress, we call them longitudinal stress. Second is by changing the shape. That stress is called shearing stress. Shearing stress is when we apply external force to a body tangentially and its shape will change but not its volume. That is called tangential stress. So like we will see what is tangential stress here. Tangential stress, or we call it shear stress. Shear stress. This type of stress is produced in a body when the force is applied tangentially to a body and its shape is changed, but not its volume. That means if we have an object like this, your object like this. So we will make it simpler one. If we have the body like this, and we'll apply force to the body tangent to the this face is fixed. It is fixed face. Fixed face. And this face is free. It is not fixed. This cube, it is the cube. When we apply force here to this free face, that means when we apply force, external force tangentially, the shape of the body, it will change the shape of the body, but not its, but not its volume. That means the edges may deform. We will have like this, shape may change. Shape of the body may change. Shape of the body may change by this deforming force, and this change in shape of a body without changing in the volume by this external force, by this deforming force which is acting tangentially, is called shear stress. That means this body is under shear stress. This body is under shear stress. So shear stress, you can simply write stress produced by a tangential force, stress produced by a tangential force per unit area is called shear stress. Shear stress. That is changing the shape of a body. Changing the shape of a body without changing its volume is called shear stress. Is called shear stress. Now we have another stress that is called bulk stress, or we call it volume stress. Now another type is by changing the volume of the body. That means volume of the body can be changed when it is under a fluid. Due to fluid pressure, the volume of the body may decrease. The volume of the body may decrease, and that decrease develops the restoring force in the body, and that restoring force developed in the body is called bulk stress. That means if we have a body, this is body whose volume is V naught, original volume. When it is outside the fluid. Now when the body is in fluid, its shape may change. Its shape may
change by the force which is developed by the fluid on the body, and its shape may decrease, its volume may decrease such that its volume is here v naught minus delta v. V naught minus delta V. That means the volume of the body is decreased. Then the body is under stress. The restoring force developed in the body per unit area is called per unit volume. Rather, we can say per unit volume. The restoring force developed per unit volume in the body is called bulk stress or volume stress. Here it is inside the fluid. That means the body is here under a fluid. Fluid may be liquid or gas, and there will be producing a stress, and that stress is called volume stress or bulk stress. Now we have another this was about stress. Now stress, we will conclude stress. Stress is tangential stress, or you can say it is a, first we have tensile stress. Tensile stress has two types, longitudinal stress or compressional stress. Then after that we have another type of stress that is called shear stress. Shear stress is produced when the force, deforming force applied tangentially to the body and its shape is deformed but not its volume. Another is volume stress, or you can say bulk stress. Bulk stress is produced only when the body is under fluid. So by changing the volume, decreasing the volume due to fluid pressure, the body is under stress, and that stress is called bulk stress or volume stress. This is what stress. And normal stress, you have seen, first normal stress is the force developed perpendicular to the area of the body. The restoring force developed perpendicular to the surface area of a body. And normal stress has two types, tensile stress and compressional stress. Both are longitudinal stress. Now we have another term that is called strain. Like stress, we have three types of stress. One is normal stress, second is shear stress, third is bulk stress. Similarly, we have three types of strain. One type of strain is called longitudinal strain. Second is called shear strain or tangential strain. Third is called bulk strain or volumetric strain. We'll go one by one. What is strain? Strain is change in configuration. Change in configuration to the original configuration. Change in configuration to the original configuration. And you have seen the stress has three types, and that will give us the three types of this strain. One types of strain. Types of strain. One type is, first type is longitudinal strain. longitudinal strain. Second is bulk strain. Bulk strain, or you can say volume strain. Third is shear strain. These are the three types. This will change, this strain will be produced by changing the length. This strain will be produced by changing the volume. This strain will be produced by changing the angle, by changing the shape of the body, by changing the shape of the body. Now we will go one by one. First we have seen what is strain. Strain is simply, we can write strain is change in configuration. Change in configuration divided by original configuration. Change in configuration divided by original configuration, it is strain. First we will go longitudinal strain. Longitudinal strain is simply by changing the length of a body. That means it is produced by normal stress. It is produced by normal stress. Either we increase the length of a body or we decrease the length of a body. The increase in length of a body divided by its original length gives you the longitudinal strain. That means change, increase or decrease of a length of a body divided by its original length gives you longitudinal strain. Simply, it is the ratio of change in length to the original length. That means we can have longitudinal strain. Strain is equal to change in length. In short, we can write change in length delta L divided by original length by L. This is longitudinal strain. This change, it can be increase in length or decrease in length. So both represent the longitudinal strain. Another thing is here, the strain is the ratio of same two quantities. So it has a ratio of same two quantities. It does not have units or dimensions. That means it is the change in configuration divided by original length. That means it is the change in length divided by original length. There is no unit or there is no dimensions. Similarly, we have another type, that is volume strain. Now we have volume strain. Volume strain, or we can say bulk strain. Bulk strain or volume strain is simply change in volume divided by original volume. That means when it is produced by means of a volumetric stress, when a body is under bulk stress, then the strain produced in the body is called a volume strain. This type of strain is produced when the body is under and the body is under bulk citrus and is given by volume citrine is equal to change in volume, that means change in volume divided by original volume. Change in volume divided by original volume, like we can write here minus sign. This minus indicates that the volume of the body is decreased when it is under fluid. So that is why here is minus sign. So we can write change in volume divided by original volume, it gives you volume strain. It is also unitless and dimensionless. Now third type of strain we have, which is called shear strain. Shear strain, you simply know this type of strain will be produced only when the body is under shear stress. And shear stress we have gone through what is shear stress. Shear stress is simply by changing the shape of a body without changing its volume when external force is applied tangentially on a body. And we have shear stress. Shear stress is, if we have a body like this, and we have applied force F, external force, or we can say deforming force, the shape of the body may change. It will change the shape of the body. Let the body, this is fixed face, the upper face is displaced through an angle theta. Through an angle theta with the perpendicular, when the upper face is held perpendicularly with the fixed face. Let length of this, or you can say it is a cuboid, its length is L, and there is a displacement in the body, and that displacement or this change in the extension produced in the body, or you can say the deformation produced in the body is X, then we can write shear strain. Shear strain we can write in short tan theta. Tan theta, we can conclude tan theta from this triangle that this is O B C D. It is D E. From this triangle O D E, we can find tan theta. Tan theta is equal to perpendicular upon hypotenuse. That means perpendicular upon base. That is x by l. If angle is small, then tan theta is equal to theta. Therefore, we can write theta is equal to x by l, which is shear stress. So shear stress, we can define, it is the angle through which the body is displaced with respect to the fixed face when a tangential force is applied on it. This is what we have strain. So strain, we conclude strain. Strain is simply the change in configuration to the original configuration. Configuration, you know, simply it is the changing the volume, changing the length, changing the shape. So by these three parameters, we can have three types of strain.
normal strain, or we have first strain that is called a longitudinal strain, second is volume strain, third is shear strain, and you know all of them are unitless and dimensionless. It is what about strain or strain, how the numericals will be asked. We'll take a simple example. Let's take one example here. Example is we have a 4 kg mass that is being held by a rod. That means if a rod is hung from the ceiling and we attach a 4 kg mass at the free end of the rod, that means if we have it's a ceiling and an iron rod is hung from the ceiling vertically, that what we do, we will hang a 4 kg mass. We'll hang a 4 kg mass. Now we have to find the normal stress in the body. We'll have to find the stress in this body. Now the given quantity is, another given quantity is the radius. Radius is given. Radius of rod is given, that is equal to 2.00 mm. Radius. And another thing is given. It is given acceleration due to gravity. Acceleration due to gravity, G is given. That is 3.1 pi. It is given 3.1 pi meter per second square. These two quantities are given. Radius of the rod and acceleration due to gravity is given. We have to find the normal stress produced in this rod. Now we will go for tension. We know tension. Tension is equal to weight is force F, which is equal to mg. Let us give the value. We will have 4.0 into 3.1 pi newton. It is the tension produced in the rod by this 4 kg mass. Second is area of cross section. Area of cross section. Area of cross section is equal to pi r square. Pi r square. We'll keep pi here as it is, and r square. That means 2.00 mm square. It is equal to 4.0 into 10 raised power minus 6 meter. 10 raised power minus 6 meter, when we convert this millimeter into meter. Now we can find the stress. How we can find the stress? Stress is equal to force divided by area. Force is equal to 4.0 into 3.1 pi newton, and area of cross section is equal to 4.0 into 10 raised power minus 6 meters square. This 4, this will cancel.
Here also, here is pi. Pi, this pi and pi will go. So we will have 3.1 into 10 raised power 6 meter Newton per meter square, which is also called Pascal. So we have a citrus 3.1 into 10 raised power 6 that is produced in the rod having radius 2 mm and which hangs a weight 4 kg. So this is how we can have numericals like citrus and citrine. That is, I hope you have enjoyed the class and you will go through the these topics at your home and you will see how numericals will be asked regarding these topics and how we go through them. That is why, thank you very much.